There's intense light shining in right now. Just gonna be with this intensity. The sun is being reflected in dazzling. It's a good exercise to allow yourself to be dazzled and realize, oh, okay, it's not overwhelming. All this light is flooding in, as it were. So it's so bright that I can't even, you know, see the screen, hardly. That's okay. We don't need to see loss, do we? If we lose sight of loss, is that important? That's what we're afraid of. We're afraid to not see the world anymore, right? And I can't, right now, I can't see the world. I got to shut my eyes almost here. But what are we losing when we don't see the world? What are we losing? Vision of loss. Vision of loss. We no longer would be aware of loss. The loss of loss is not lost. We say, oh, well, we're losing loss. Well, that's sort of a contradiction in terms, because if you're not aware of loss, then how are you losing? How are you losing? Right? So, if we do not see the world for a moment, just a moment, forget about the world. Everything that's ever arisen in the world or ever arise, forget about it. All the heaviness, the sadness, the despair, the fear, the uncertainty of all types and all types of doubts, all sorts of vulnerabilities. If we just forget about the entire complex, just for a moment, what is it that we're losing? Well, we're losing one moment to pat our resume is all we're losing. Because we want to open our eyes, you know, it's there again, right? So we're just not padding our resume for one moment. And it's testimony to how desperate we feel in existence, that we feel we need to pad our resume every single moment. That's the only hope we have, right? We got to use every moment here on this earth to pad our resume. And that's how we feel. So we don't even for one minute really drop it. And when we go to sleep, we still dream dreams of loss and vulnerability, right? Hey, dazzling. So, why not, for just one moment, drop the awareness of loss? We can do it. That's what we need to do, just for a moment. Just so to realize, it's okay. And yet I guarantee you that most of us will spend our entire lives not doing that. Almost everyone spends an entire lifetime, not even once, for a moment, dropping awareness of loss, awareness of this world, which is lost. This world is nothing but loss. There's nothing in this world that won't be lost. Nothing. It's all loss. We just choose among various forms of loss. You know, that's what we just say, well, this loss I want to see, this other one here I'm not so interested in. And that's why we spend our time. But what if we were to just pay no interest to any of it for just a minute? Not a minute, a moment. And we may think, well, we need to protect others from loss. That's why we need to see it. And we'll throw up all sorts of excuses. As we've seen, these are bogus excuses. Loss doesn't profit anyone. And stopping, trying to prevent loss, that is just another way of saying that reality is vulnerable to loss. So we need to work hard to prevent it here. You know, that's what we need to do, is simply drop our awareness of it altogether. So we're not aware of loss at all. We're not even focused on loss at all. And see where that gets us. Now, can drugs do that? Not at all. No, drugs do not accomplish what we really want at all. I do not. It just goes dark like that, you know. It's going dark. The true dropping of all loss? No. It's like shutting our eyes, but we still are thinking about loss, right? So that doesn't do the trick. We need something much more profound than that. To in our spirit, to for a moment just drop loss altogether and say, we don't need to be aware of it or even think about it or even be aware that it's a possibility. You see, even be aware that it's a possibility. We're not trying to make forms of loss attractive, trying to find attractive forms or thinking, well, we'll drop this loss and not another, not using judgment at all. What form of loss do we want? No, we just decide to drop it all. We'll just drop all loss. Not even be aware that there's any such thing as loss. Just for a moment. I know I've done it several moments. One time during sleep, I believe I did it. Because I woke up out of that sleep feeling profoundly refreshed. Wow. And that's the only time I can ever remember that. Usually I wake up out of sleep feeling very tired, like I've been experiencing all sorts of loss. But this time, it's like I had taken a dip in some holy river that had refreshed me entirely. And it was amazing. That's what happens. That is what true meditation is. True meditation is to take a dip in that divine river, as it were, of forgetfulness. The divine river of forgetfulness. Forgetfulness of loss, so we don't, not even remembering of that it's possible. We go in that river. Like this, you see. Very gentle. We don't even have any idea about loss. And then eventually when we wake up, it comes back to us. And we say, oh, okay. So that there is something like that in this world. We say, okay. It starts to reform. The memories come back. The memories. Oh, yeah. You know, oh, yeah, I remember that. And I remember that. And all of that. So, but we can take that dip in the river of forgetfulness. And we should pray for that every night, every evening, that we, instead of having dreams, take a dip in the river of forgetfulness. What a blessing that is, you know. And I don't know how I managed to do it for one time, you know, and get it done, and then not be able to do it again. See, that's the question. You do it one time, how come you can't do it again? And we should be able to. So it's important to bring this up as a goal so that we gradually get oriented towards our goals, because we forget our goals in this world, don't we? We're so focused on other stuff, we forget what our goals really are. One of them is, for sure, when we go to bed, we should not ask for all sorts of happy dreams. No. Ask to dip in the river of forgetfulness entirely, where we forget loss altogether. Ramana Maharshi was able to go into that state when he was young. When he dreamed, he would go to sleep and he would literally become entirely oblivious to the world. So much so that his friends were able to take him out around town, put him in cabs, you know, I don't know if they have, probably pedal cabs, whatever, and take him on a trip all around town. They'd go out and do all the stuff, visit friends, go, and then they'd bring him back to his house, put him back into bed, and the entire time he was completely oblivious, totally asleep. It was unbelievable. That obliviousness that Ramana was in, even as a child and a young boy, then a teenager. Once he would go to sleep, he would go into that obliviousness of loss, and he wasn't in any hurry to come out of that. So whatever, you know, whatever his friends wanted to do, they would take him around, all around town, and it was a great, you know, it was a fun thing for them to do. You know, they got a lot of laughs out of it because they were amazed by it. You know, look at our friend. They'd say, look at our friend. He's sound asleep. And they'd, hey, Romano, you know, what was his name? Ben Cotteron or something. And they'd say, hey. You know, tap him. Hey, wake up. You awake? Can you hear me? Can you wake? Totally asleep. And then they'd, you know, honk the horns. You know, they have guys honking horns, whatever. All, you know, how kids are. I mean, having fun with it. They had fun with it. And they would bring him back, and he'd wake up, and they'd say, do you remember anything? He said, no. Because he was in the land of forgetfulness. We believe that when we go to sleep, we're in the land of forgetfulness. That is not true. We have all sorts of dreams. I know when I go to sleep, I'm just incredible tapestry of multidimensional dreaming, of activity, of all sorts of stuff that I would never, ever think up while I'm awake. Literally. I mean, the stuff in my dreams is I never would have ever thought of this experiencing or do this or that at all. At all. It's unbelievable. And yet none of that is forgetfulness of loss. None of it. It's all vulnerability, you know. I'm escaping this or escaping that, or, you know, it's like Mission Impossible on steroids sometimes. Mission Impossible 10. You know, I mean, just absolutely incredible stuff of being able to escape from this and this and this and this and that. And, oh my gosh. I mean, it makes any movie look dull by comparison. Extremely dull. It's unbelievable. I have to wake up and I just sort of let this, you know, dreams be reverberating. And I said, holy cow, how could I ever have ever thought up anything like that? Seems impossible. But so, and yet that none of that is refreshing. It's not refreshing. Don't wake up refreshed. Wake up like you've been running all night. But the dip in the river of forgetfulness, upon awaking from that, you feel like reborn. Somebody, you know, said, oh my God, I feel like a new, fresh being. St. Paul said, I die daily. You know, is that dipping in that river of forgetfulness, that divine river, where we don't need to remember anything about loss at all. That should be our goal when we go to sleep. When we're awake, our goal should be clarification. To very clearly see the situation that we're in, to accept it, and to repent, to work on clarity towards repentance. Of admitting to ourselves we've been running the scam on the Prime Creator, trying to scam the Prime Creator, trying to get the Prime Creator to alter a tiny bit of reality for us, which we know would then means it would wipe out all of reality. Reality would be no more, which is what we're trying, that's our goal, so that we can be Prime Creator. Because in reality, we're not Prime Creator. We never will be. So our only way to achieve being Prime Creator is to wipe out reality. And we know we can wipe it out if the Prime Creator would change even the tiniest bit in any way. It would wipe out all of reality, because reality, its very nature is that it's all one. Everything operates under the same oneness. Perfect freedom, perfect equality, perfect invulnerability to the laws, all this can never change. That is reality. So we know if we can even get the tiniest change, it would wipe out all of reality. So that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to get the Prime Creator to change it, because we can't change it, you know, but we think maybe the Prime Creator can change it. So daytime we focus on clarification, nighttime we focus on forgetfulness. Now some people in meditation can go into that state of forgetfulness. It's called samadhi or nirvana. And then recall the highest samadhi is open-eyed, where even with your eyes open, you're in a state of forgetfulness of it. You don't see any loss anywhere. But we don't need to worry about all that stuff. The gradations, the levels. No. That's not our goal. Our goal is not to become sort of a idiot savant where we can explain all these levels and stuff. I think that the Buddha criticized his devotee, saying, you know, you can enumerate all of this stuff. You got all this conceptual clarity and wisdom, etc. But you're not abiding in this forgetfulness of loss. You haven't repented, you know. So you don't, you know, that's all this. You're an idiot savant. That's not the goal. It's not the goal. That's why I don't dwell on details. And I don't care whether I got the details right or not. I don't care, you know, what Ramana's first name was when he was a teenager. I think it was Venkatarana, whatever, but it doesn't matter. The narrative is not halted because of that. Details don't halt the narrative, because the narrative is the big picture thing. And that big picture thing is powerful. We keep on moving on towards it. Don't let anything stop us. Very important to keep on moving on like that. Every day, keep clarifying, keep on moving on towards that. And then in the night, pray for that forgetfulness. You know, I'll tell you this, it's even more important to dip into the river of forgetfulness than it is to meet any guru, okay? Let's bring this up into the light here. Very important. Because I have met many gurus during sleep. I've also met some doubles, some etheric doubles that those who are engaged in trying to deceive the world, call whatever you want. A lot of people have called them reptiles. A lot of people have called them etheric vampires, you know, whatever. Again, those are details that are not important, because the narrative is way more important. So you meet these fake gurus, you meet true gurus sometimes, really. But I can tell you from my own experience that dipping in the river of forgetfulness is totally superior to that. Totally. Totally superior. And you may wonder, well, how come the gurus don't show up to me? Maybe because the gurus are waiting for you to take that dip in the river of forgetfulness, right? And they're saying, if I keep showing up in your dreams, you're going to become addicted to that, and you think, that's what I need. So when you go to sleep, you'll be focused on that. You'll be focused on trying to dream, a dream of a guru, trying to get in contact with the guru, etc., etc., right? You don't want that. You don't really want that. That is not the goal. The goal is to go into that state of absolute oblivion of loss. It's not oblivion of everything. It is oblivion to loss, as if loss never took place. It is to touch that which has never suffered loss. That is really the goal. So forget about the gurus. You know, if they come, they come. Don't make that your goal. Don't worry about it one way or the other. Don't feel like, oh, that you're inferior because, oh, I've never had a dream of I've never been in contact with a guru or anything like that. It doesn't matter. That doesn't matter at all. It doesn't mean you're, you know, it doesn't have any bearing on your situation at all. If you have dipped in the river of forgetfulness even once, that's better than meeting any guru there is, really. Because that gives you this immediate, direct, unambiguous, undeniable experience. And you say, I know, I've been there, I've done that, I know it's possible. That is more important than anything. When you wake up that one time and you feel reborn. For me, it didn't last. It didn't last long. It lasted a while. And then later in the day, I got tired. As normal. But for a while there, you know, I said, oh my gosh. I'm a new person, you know. I somehow, the afflictions and the burdens and the cares and stuff have been washed away. And this is what the various teachings talk about. How have your sins washed away. That is what baptism is all about, really. Baptism with water, it is referring to this being immersed in forgetfulness of the world. And when you baptize the baby, the idea is that you are putting them on the right path towards this forgetfulness of loss, signifying this is what your life, you know, needs to be about, that we've given you, that we're giving you this opportunity. Symbolizes it. Now, some people take these rituals literally, you know, the symbolic rituals literally, which is not true, because it's not a literal immersion in forgetfulness of loss. And anyone who's actually experienced a literal immersion will know that these external rituals are but symbols. But there's nothing wrong with symbolizing that. There's no harm in it, you know, and there's some benefit to it. Sort of having this vague, you know, conviction, yeah, there's some way for me to be immersed in something that washes my quote-unquote sins away, meaning all of my experiences of loss, the remembrance of that can be submerged and gone temporarily. The ultimate goal is for it to be drop it entirely. Let go of the whole pain body, the grievance, the loss body, the entire complex, the loss-based complex, all of that, let it go, let it go. That's, you know, that's the goal. That is the goal. That's one powerful goal. And the more we experience, and some meditators can get into this, the more they're able to get into that, the closer they become to letting it all go. So there's no memory, no trace in them. Because why? Because again, it's useless to them. It serves no purpose at all. Never will serve any purpose. Never will. And so it's not a loss of anything that we want. Not a loss of anything that we want. So we're all moving towards that. All moving towards that. We'll all get there someday. That is for sure. We're just trying to get there sooner rather than later. That's the only reason that we're working on this. Sooner, we'd rather have it sooner than later. That's it. There's no, you know, it's not like when you're on the path, you're like some superior being. It's just you're saying, I want it sooner rather than later. And other people are saying, no, they want it a little bit later, you know. It's like saying, I want my dessert now. Others are saying, no, I want it later. Okay, whatever. But it's a good time. Good time now to do it. It's always a good time. Never more, you know, never more so than now, because all of the reinforcement of loss is coming, and we might be tempted to think, wow, here's a chance to pad my resume. So I'm not going to go into forgetfulness of loss. I mean, I think it's right now, it's very difficult for us to get into that immersion in forgetfulness of loss, because there's so much loss taking place. We think, my gosh, I may wake up in the morning and overnight, you know, somebody may have shot up a situation, right? And I want to follow the story. You know, somebody detonated something, somebody blew up something, somebody shot something, you know, something, somebody, you know, something, some powerful loss took place, and you think, oh, I don't want to miss that. I might have missed it. I was getting into the habit of checking Google News constantly, you know, every 10 minutes. And you don't want to miss a story, right? And now I stopped that. I haven't accessed any news for, you know, about the last, 4 days, I think. Also on a diet. Unbelievable. Dropped 7 pounds in 3 days. I say it's go time. You know, it really is go time. So we're talking about go time. What does it mean? It means you take it seriously. You say, you know what? I've got one more burst in me. Now's the time to use it. You're going to light one more rocket. You know, you've got the last one. It's the last one. It's one more. You have one more token. You put in the jukebox and you play that tune. You say, all right, this is my favorite tune. I'm going to play it now because I need the boost. So right now I decided, all right, it's time. I got one more burst in me. Let's go for that burst. And I was, you know, gone way overweight because the stress of the times, I just decided, well, you know what? I'm just going to enjoy food. Why not? Why not? Just enjoy food. I haven't really done that much in my life. I've really kind of like not allowed myself to do that. So I said, okay, bring it on. All the ice cream, all the gelato, all the sweets, the pastries, the chocolate cakes, all of the chips, the dips, anything and everything. I didn't rule anything out. I just like, I said, as much as I want. If I want to eat a quart of ice cream, I'll eat a quart of ice cream. Whatever. It doesn't matter. And so, of course, I would, ballooned up. And then I said, uh-oh, you know, I'm getting into kind of a dark place here. I said, ooh. And then I decided, well, let me just see if I just cut back on sweets, what's going to happen. And I kind of stayed the same. And then one morning, I was 2 pounds lighter. And I said, all right, it's doable. Let's do it. Let's do it. And then, pow, I just cut out the eating, you know, kind of went on a liquid diet. I'm going to have like a liquid protein diet, basically. And in 3 days, I've dropped 7 pounds. And stop watching the news. Stop checking the news, you know. I mean, gosh, Google News is horrible, you know. I mean, it's just saturated with disasters and loss of every type. Hardcore. And that just like pounds you over and over and over, you know. Rebels here, rebels there. You know, service people here, service people there. Accidents here, accidents there. Some crazy person losing their brakes and inflicting, you know, loss on a situation. And it's on and on and on and on and on. It's never ending, right? All this loss is every day. If you want a steady diet of calamity, just keep checking the internet headlines, you know, because it'll just give you the steady diet of that. And so I said, you know what? It's go time. I'm kind of monitoring the world as to how bad it's getting. But, you know, we already know how terrible it is. It's horrible. Don't need to keep monitoring it every 10 minutes. So you might want to go on a diet. Think about that. A news diet, a food diet, to see if you can ease into that. And the way I did it again, I said, I've got one more burst of willpower. I know I have at least one. I said, maybe this is the last because I'm tired. My whole life has been a battle of will against, you know, against deception to keep battling. And it's just use as will to will to do it, determination. At some point, you just say, my gosh, you know, I'm tired of the battle. Tired of the battle. Even the greatest warrior gets tired of the battle at some point. And I was just tired. I said, that's it. I'm just going to eat whatever I want and sleep and do nothing. And then, you know, I realized, well, I do have one more burst. I know I can summon my will one more time. So why not? Why keep it in reserve, right? Why keep it in reserve? Because I said, well, you know, this next 4 months, September, October, November, December, 4.5 months is crucial. If not now, then when? If not now, then when? Because by that time, it's going to be too late. You know, if we keep our will in reserve, the end of 2012, I pretty much guarantee you that you will be so disheartened in so many ways that you won't even be able to use your will at that point. It'll be you may have lost the opportunity. And that's what I saw. I said, uh-oh. If I don't use it now, I may never use it. It's like I say, if I don't diet now, I probably never will. I'll probably just let it go. It'll be too hard to bring it back. Too hard. And you say, what the heck? Let's just, you know, eat cake every day. And literally, I was on an ice cream diet, a gelato diet. I was just saying, like, whatever I wanted, you know, I just eat ice cream 10 times a day. Yeah. I didn't feel like anything else. I said, this is great. I'm hungry, go eat a cup of ice cream, you know, a bowl of ice cream, just go for it, throw some nuts on it, do whatever you want to do. And so there's a point where we feel so disheartened by the world, you know, where we just say, you know what, I give up, you know, what am I fighting for anyway, this is ridiculous, let's just give up on this. And what the heck, you know? Why do I even need to be in shape? Why do I even need to battle through this? It's never going to get better, right? So just consider at this time using your will one last time. One last time. For the heck of it, why not? Why not? If you're a warrior, be a warrior. You know, go out in battle, as it were. Go out using everything you've got. Don't just meekly, you know, slump down and say, I've had enough, I can't do anymore. Keep it going, right now especially. Because right now the opportunity to have a breakthrough is so important. To recognize that the bluffing God will never work. To recognize that waiting for God to accept a deal that's not even a deal at all will never work. To recognize that maintaining loyalty with futility will never get anywhere. To recognize that we can repent. The time is now for that. We can do it now. Because the world is spiraling out of control. It's really spiraling out of control. That is the truth. You know, even when something is spiraling, you know, we think, well, maybe they'll pull out of it. Like if you've seen a plane like goes into a out of control spiral, you're always thinking, oh no, the pilot will pull out of it. Pilot will pull out of it, yeah. And then you see it keep going and going and going. You say, come on, pilot, pull out of it. Come on, pull out of it. And sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. And, you know, so I'm saying, even though the world is in this spiral, this death spiral, this sacrificial spiral, we still think there's some sort of control to it. We still think, oh no, the pilot knows what they're doing. Really, I'm saying that right now the world is in this death spiral. It's out of control. Nobody's controlling it. But we are just hoping and assuming that someone's controlling it. And the pilot can pull out. We think, you know, we got a pilot in control of this situation that can, you know, get the wing flaps and pull back properly and pull it out of this spiral. It's not going to happen. It's not happening. We don't have that pilot there. We have pilots in the world who don't know how to fly a plane, tell you the truth. And that's why they're there. So we don't pull out of it. We've put people in positions of leadership and power in this world that can't fly the plane. They're not pilots. They might have stayed at a Holiday Inn Express one night, you know, and they got up in the morning and said, hey, you know, I can pilot this baby. Let me, give me the controls. But they're not pilots. They don't know how to get out of the spin. And so we just kind of assume, oh no, things will be fine. They will not. Look at that Air France plane that crashed off the coast of Brazil, I think it was. You know, all sorts of stuff went wrong. You know, stuff froze up, the instruments weren't working properly, and the pilots weren't trained properly. They weren't experienced enough to know what was going on, even though the instruments were completely out of whack. They kept flying by the instruments. They couldn't take control of it manually. The computer was getting wrong in data. And so instead of, they thought they were going, they thought they were going up or something, and so they wanted to tilt the plane down, and it was actually going down. So in this world right now, we don't have the pilots to pull us out of the spiral. There aren't any such pilots in control of the plane, and the cockpit is closed, you know. So there's no way that this scenario of the world is in is going to pull out of the spiral. I know, we got to say, we got to get someone in there that can fly this baby. It's already so badly out of control that is something that is just a vain hope. But again, when you're in a plane that is spiraling downwards, you are going to have this conviction that for sure this is just an aberration, and the pilot is going to pull the plane out of that. For sure, you're going to have that conviction. You will have that conviction. And so we're in this world right now, and we have this conviction that the world is going to get better, that we're going to pull out of this. We have to have that. I don't think there's hardly anyone on the planet that doesn't hope for that. I hope for it, of course. We all do. We all want to pull out of this spiral. But I'm just saying that realistically, pragmatically, the truth of the matter is that there is no one, you know, we're not going to pull out of it. Because the purpose of it is that we don't pull out of it. And our collective will is that we don't pull out of it. That is why. Because we want to pad our resume of loss. And we know that by not pulling out of it, that's how we're going to do it. So those few of us who don't want to pad our resume of loss, we have to realize that we're not going to pull out of this and respond accordingly. Okay, again, when we go to sleep, make the goal to dip in the river of forgetfulness of loss. When we're awake, work on clarity towards repentance, getting aligned towards repentance. And what that does, it activates the Passover principle, where all the whole scenario of loss will pass us by. We need to do that. Stop just waiting on vain hopes, waiting on the hope that some heroic pilot will come along and solve everything for us. No, the plane is just about ready to hit the water, as it were. So we are, there's a certain point when in a spiral like that where it's too late to come out of it. You know, we've passed that point long ago. You know, the election, honestly, it doesn't really matter. It's too late to pull out. You know, no matter who's elected in any position in the world right now, it's like the plane is going, 1,000 miles an hour straight down, and it's about ready to plunge into the ocean. And there is no stick you can pull on, no flaps, no rudder, no nothing you can do to take it out of that dive at this point. And yet we all hope that this can happen. So don't fight against that hope. I'm not saying don't be hopeless. No, I hope all the time it will happen. But more importantly than that, I plan for it not happening. Hope for the best, but prepare for the worst. Trust, but verify. These things you got to do. Set your goals high. Set your goals for forgetfulness of loss. Get prepared to be translated into the loss-free realm before this whole thing, goes into fragmentation, as it will do very soon, very soon. And remain calm and just say, okay, this thing is out of control. I'm not going to get it back under control. So I need this whole situation to pass me over. Okay, be passed this pass me over. Let this pass over. Let me not defend any loss. Let me not be defensive of any loss. Let me be willing to forget all about loss. Let me be willing to realize that reality needs no defense. Let me accept this fact that reality needs no defense. Therefore, I don't need to be aware of any loss to defend against. I don't need to be looking for what is the worst type of loss that might cause reality to be harmed. And I don't need to find that and then help defend reality against that. I don't need to do that. I can be completely forgetful of loss because reality is not threatened by loss by any kind whatsoever. Keep doing these things, even in the face of everything spiraling into, fragmentation. And even though you have some hope that, yeah, it's going to get better, okay, that's fine. But don't put all your eggs in that basket. Continue to put your eggs in a basket of real hope, where what is certain safety. Put your efforts towards certain safety. I call it the safe way. Put your efforts towards that. Guaranteed safety, right? Guaranteed non-loss. place your efforts in that direction, you know, this whole scenario can pass you by, literally, automatically. You will find yourself in a loss-free place, like paradise. It'll be a paradise, no vulnerability, no loss. You don't need to defend reality. Reality needs no defense. In other words, God did not place you here to be a special agent to defend against some super tricky form of loss. No, not at all. Reality is not threatened by any loss. It's not threatened by any trickery either. So you don't even have to be aware of the slightest bit of loss. It's not necessary. You can forget all about loss. Keep that goal in your heart. Keep that goal in your mind, your spirit. Keep your attention there. Keep that narrative going in your life. And you will realize, there's certain safety. And if some pilot's able to pull the world out of this downward spiral, then hey, great, you know. But still, this world is full of constant loss. It's just that we're ready for some very intense fragmentation that we're not used to here. So you're going to win. It's a win-win-win-win-win situation by focusing on this. You're focusing on the total win, the only real win there is. And if you get some crumbs from the world suddenly becoming a very great place, you know, those crumbs, well, you'll have those crumbs too. You'll have your cake and some crumbs. Both. But if you only go for the crumbs, all you'll have is a few little crumbs. You don't want, at best, if you trust in this world, at best you'll have a few little crumbs, at very best. Whereas if you go the safe way, the real safe way, the very least you will have is the entire cake. All right? And when you have the entire cake, you don't really worry about the crumbs. Because the cake is huge. There's no end to the cake. So since there's no end to the cake, why worry about the crumbs at all? We only worry about the crumbs when we have a little piece, right? We get a little piece and we say, I want to eat all those crumbs because I'm hungry. But if the piece of cake you have the whole cake, and the cake is goes on forever, why are you going to worry about crumbs? Why are you worried about what happens in this world, whether it's, you know, adverse disaster or not? That's just crumbs, because this world is 100% loss anyway. It's just that the rate of loss is kind of, we're used to the rate of loss, we're kind of adjusted to it. And yeah, we know that tree there is going to die, and we know our friends are going to die, we know everything's going to die, we know that the flowers are going to wilt and die, and you know, we know we're going to get old, and we just kind of, you know, we're adjusted to this, we're resigned to it. But when the rate of loss gets goes out of control, you know, we're not adjusted to that. We really are not adjusted to that. It's like, wow. I mean, even over in the war zones, the people there, you know, are adjusted to being bombed every day, you know, just seeing all this horrible stuff happening every day. They adjust to it. But even them, there's things that, you know, they're not adjusted to either. And for us here, oh boy, you know, intense loss that we're not prepared for, not, you know, adjusted to. Look out. You know, that's bad news for us. So we don't want that. We don't want that. Let's go for the whole cake. Go for the whole cake, not the crumbs. The whole enchilada. Go for the whole enchilada. Very warm day today. Hungry too. Hungry because I haven't eaten very much of anything. But hey, if you want to go for it, go for it. You know, don't say, well, don't do half measures right now. Give that final burst. It's like you've still got a gallon of gasoline in the truck or the car, and you say, well, you know, I've been not driving my car at all because I only have one more gallon left, and I'm afraid, you know, I don't want to use it up. But you know what? If you just can go 10 more miles, you'll finish. You'll be there. So why not turn the car on, and you can get 10 miles with that gallon of gasoline. It's finishing that's all important. It's not how much gas you have when you finish. That doesn't matter. As long as you finish, it doesn't matter if you finish with an empty tank or a full tank. Same thing. It's only all finishing is all important. Getting proper alignment is all important. So spend the time now. Spend the time, like I'm doing here. Be willing to spend the time. You won't regret it, because our will not get better here. They're going to get so bad. You can every day. It's coming on strong. Lack of stability, the projection, the polarization, the frustration, the hostility, the demonization. That's a recipe for disaster here. And it's just spiraling out of control, completely out of control. I tried to stop it, tell you the truth. I really tried to stop it. And got nowhere. I just dragged myself down into it, you know, terrible. I tried to bring civility to the internet. I tried all sorts of stuff. Really, I've tried so many things. Doesn't work. You just get hammered. So, there again, it's not necessary. Let it come. Let whatever wants to come in existence, let it come. Reality's not threatened. Let everyone pad their resume. Okay? That's okay. God is not fooled by any resume of loss. He's not deceived. Cannot deceive the prime creator. So don't be concerned about whatever padding of resume may take place over the coming times. There'll be a lot of resume padders in this world. A lot. Don't be worried about them. Let them pad their resume. Let them get into whatever they want to get into. If that's what they want, you know. Don't try and stand in their way, because they'll knock you over. They're very intent on padding their resume. That's what they want to do. And they want you to help them pad their resume, you know. They'll either say, here, strike me down, or let me strike you down. You know, that's the option. And if you say, no, I don't want to be struck down, they'll say, well, then strike me down. And if you say, no, I don't want to do that, they'll say, you're crazy. Get out of my life. I hate you. Yeah, I've had situations where people literally said, you know, victimize these, you know, strike me down. And I said, what? What are you talking about? You crazy? And I said, no, that's what I want. And I said, whoa, you know, that's nuts. No, because they wanted they were professional victims. They wanted their resume padded. And I told them, look, you've gone through this and this and this and horrible stuff. I've met people that have gone through horrible stuff, horrible lives. And I said, look, you've gone through all this stuff, and yet you want even more. You want it to be even worse. I said, what are you doing? What are you up to, you know? Well, they're up to padding their resume. So they believe they can trick God. That's what they're up to. And their way is the victimization way. And there are others who go around bullying everybody. And that's their way, is to victimize others and show, look at the vulnerability I can create. Look what I can do. Again, to try and trick God. But we don't want to do either one of those things, right? So basically the world will look at us and say, you're useless. The world already looks at me as useless. The collective consciousness of this planet views me as completely useless. Not everybody. Those who view these videos are said, you know, hey, we see that you got some use here, and thank you for that. But the collective consciousness of the world sees me as entirely useless. You have nothing for me to do except pick up garbage, which is what I do, basically. Because that's the only role that they see that I'm fit for is basically nothing. Useless. Lowest of the low. Because I don't want to pad anyone's resume with loss. I don't want to pad mine. I don't want to pad anyone else's. I don't want to contribute to any situation that pads the resume of loss. Because it's futile. It's a waste of my time. I don't want to keep wasting my time. It just causes more delay. So collectively, the world sees no use for me. So maybe collectively, the world will simply pass me by, you know, soon. I feel it will. I feel that the Passover principle is working in my life. I may find myself in some very beautiful place soon. Very beautiful. And I think when I just stop trying to even help the world at all with the lost resume, really drop it, then I really will be passed over, and you know, entirely. Right now, I'm passed over 99%. But still, they say, "Well, if you want to clean our toilets, if you want to pick up trash or something, I'll do that." You know, because maybe I have like tiny fragment of still wanting to, you know, stop people from padding their resume. So, but when I give that up entirely, say, I don't even care if people want to pad their resume. Go ahead, go for it if they want. If that's what you want to do, I don't need to stay on your way. Doesn't bother me. Then at that point, the full Passover principle will be engaged, and it will probably result in me finding myself in some extraordinarily beautiful place. Not that this place here isn't beautiful, it is, but probably not even having to pick up garbage. Probably not even having to clean toilets, you know, as it were. I'm not actually doing that. I have in the past. You know, I did some janitorial work. Basically, the world doesn't want to give me any work at all, because it sees me as useless. And maybe you're probably experiencing something similar like that. The world just views you as useless. You know, what use can you be? You don't want to victimize? You don't want to be victimized. You don't want to pad the resume of loss and vulnerability and threat? You don't want to pad that at all? You're useless. You're just a useless, you know, get out of here. Get out of here. That's what they're saying, get out of here. I say, okay. And I'm just staying here because I want to maybe probably limit loss or something, but that's also, again, delusional, because God doesn't care one way or the other. It's not the right kind of witnessing. The right kind of witnessing is unconcern, you know. Whatever anyone wants to do is okay. That unconcern is the right kind of witnessing here. And a step towards that would be to go to a very beautiful place, you know, crime-free place, where everything seems to be really, 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 really nice, and not even have to work. Because in paradise, there's no, you know, you don't have to work. You don't have to work. There's no working. You're in bliss. You just appreciate and enjoy the entire place. So the step towards paradise is to be in a place where you simply enjoy everything, and you don't even have to work at it. And for some reason, the world just passed me by because the screen just went blank, entirely blank. What's going on here? I don't know if there's any video showing up at all here. The screen just suddenly went blank. Wow. I'm back. Wow. Very interesting. I didn't do that. I did not do that. You see? That is very interesting. The whole picture just dropped out entirely, like I was passed over right there. All right. Very good. The Passover principle. Trust in it, rely upon it, and I hope that I can reinforce your trust in it, because I know it's not an easy thing to trust in, because it's something we're kind of new at. And if I can help reinforce it for you, I'll do it. I mean, right now, I am in a beautiful place. But I still have to work. I have to work very hard cleaning up, I mean, in dust, you know. Cleaning up, raking, cleaning, dumping stuff that's just choking me with dust. I'm at the end of the day, I'm filthy, dirty. In other words, like the lowest kind of job. I have to do that because the world sees no other purpose for me. So the next step would be to not have to do that, you know, be in a very beautiful place and not and simply be able to be immersed in the joy of it, so to speak, the beauty of it, and then convey that to you, that the Passover principle is working. So I hope I can be a witness to that. Really, I'll pray on that. And in the meantime, I will keep doing these videos to bolster your hope. Keep bolstering that your conviction, your deep conviction that this is possible, this is true, that we're talking about here. This is not, I'm just not talking off the, you know, uninformed top of my head, you know, blah, 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 blah. This is a result of my entire life of intense study and determination to try and align in the right direction, getting the very best help possible. You know, you cannot get better help than I've gotten. And I've just worked at it nonstop. So it's informed. This is, you know, this is very informal talk because it's not written down, or I'm not reading a teleprompter here at all. Okay, I'm not a teleprompter guy. But it's informed. It's informal, but informed. Okay, it's informed talk. What we're talking about is entirely serious, super important. And the fact is that we keep it chatty and informal here, and not all, you know, I'm just letting whatever happens happen here, keeping it loose, so it's not, you know, we don't think there's some, like, serious thing, like we've got to remember now, how many, you know, how long was the video, 1 hour and 27 minutes and 3 seconds or something, how, you know, doesn't matter, keep it loose, keep it relaxed, keep it fun, and keep it serious all at the same time, and keep your strength of convictions going. And again, I'll keep trying to do as much as possible. This is the weekend here, so I'm able to relax a little bit. All right, very great. That is enough for now.